Hi, have you ever wondered what actually causes epilepsy? In this video, we will explain in depth what is epilepsy, what causes epilepsy, how it happens in the brain, and how to successfully treat it and get control of it. I am Dr. Omar Danoun, and for the last 7 years, I've been studying complex epilepsy and specialized in epilepsy in depth, which is called epileptologist, and I have trained at the Mayo Clinic. So let's start by looking at what and how epilepsy and seizures happen in the brain. First, epilepsy is a neurological condition that causes recurrent seizures. Epilepsy is a fairly common condition, happens in 1 in 100 people in the population. In the United States, it is estimated to at least have 3 million people with epilepsy and about 50 to 70 million people worldwide with epilepsy, so you're not alone. Epilepsy is like a fire caused by excess electricity in the brain. The electricity in the brain is tightly regulated by channels and receptors. There are two types of signals in the brain. The excitation signals, or the sparks of electricity, is the glutamate system and the sodium and calcium channels. In epilepsy, this system is working too much and causing seizures to happen. And the firefighters, or the inhibition system in the brain, are the GABA receptors and the chloride and potassium channels. This system is working less in epilepsy, leading to uncontrolled seizures. So it's kind of imbalance, lots of excitation and too little of inhibition. And it is very important to understand this relationship, because this is where the targets of all the treatments that we try to control the seizures and balance the electricity back in the brain, as we will discuss further in the treatment section. So let's look at the different types of seizures next. There are different types of seizures based on the International League Against Epilepsy classification, and this can be focal seizures, where the seizure starts from one spot in the brain, and this can be with focal aware, where the patient is having a seizure but still is aware of their surroundings, or impaired awareness, when the patient loses awareness and loses consciousness as well during the seizure. Think of the seizure as turning the switch on in some place, and whatever that area of the brain is doing, it will do a lot during the seizure. If the seizure happens in the motor cortex of the brain, then the patient will have excess movements like a jerking of their face or arm or leg. If the seizure happens in the sensory cortex, where the sensation happens, then the patient will have tingling, numbness, or abnormal sensation. If the seizure happens in the memory area, which is common in the temporal lobe and the hippocampus, where the memory happens, the patient might have deja vu or jamais vu, which means like the feeling familiar happens before or feeling unfamiliar. And this is related to memory, or maybe hearing some quotes or some specific memories that come back. Or it can happen in the emotional area, which is called the amygdala, and the patient will have emotional experiences like sudden intense fear or crying or laughing. All of these can be emotions due to seizures or sudden anxiety. If it happens all the way back in the occipital area, the patient might see flashes of lights or bubbles of lights or any of that vision phenomena. And even here in the insula, the seizures can happen with autonomic symptoms, which is the control of the autonomic system. Can patient have drooling, throat constriction, or even changes in the skin color, and even goosebumps? Yes, goosebumps can be a sign of a seizure, and it often also happens in the temporal lobe. So I have patients with goosebumps in their right hand, and the seizure is in the left temporal lobe. All of these types of seizures can spread to other areas of the brain and leading to shaking all over, which is called focal to bilateral tonic-clonic seizures. Other type of seizures is generalized onset seizures. When the electricity happens all over the brain and rapidly jolting the whole brain, then we see symptoms all over the body, like absence seizures, when the body just disconnects and then be staring, or myoclonic seizures, when there is a jerk, or clonic, multiple jerks, or even atonic, when there is sudden loss of all the muscle and tone in the body, and that leads to drop attacks, and that can be causing lots of injuries, especially in certain syndromes of epilepsy. And sometimes seizures can be very hard to classify. After the seizure, the patient might be confused, tired, even agitated, and this is a state called post-ictal state, or after seizure state, and that can last for a few minutes to a few hours, and it is also associated with memory loss or rapid memory issues, or even tiredness and muscle soreness. And sometimes it can be with one-sided weakness, usually where the seizure starts, and this is called Todd's paralysis, or Todd's paresis, named after Dr. Todd, of course, the one who described it first. If it feels like complex and you need more information, rest assured, because this whole channel is designed for epilepsy and seizures to get you the best results and best control of your seizures. So feel free to explore all the channels for all the videos that you need. Now let's go to the types of epilepsy as a whole. Epilepsy as a diagnosis, there are two types. One of it is called focal epilepsy, when seizure starts in one spot in the brain. And the other type, it's called generalized epilepsy, when usually seizures happen all over the brain at once. That usually is caused by genetic causes that increase the electricity all over the brain. And it is very important to tell the difference and ask your doctor, doctor, am I having focal epilepsy or generalized epilepsy? Because the treatment can be completely different. And we know that even some medications for focal epilepsy can make generalized epilepsy worse. So it is very important to tell the difference. Next is how we diagnose epilepsy. Diagnosis of epilepsy needs a little bit of pieces of a puzzle. We put all those pieces to make the final diagnosis. Starting with a detailed history and physical examination, your doctor will perform a detailed description of all your events, and it's very, very valuable to have a video recording of the event, because that can be very, very important in understanding what's going on in the body. You can describe it, but a video will show it really well. So pull up the phone and record yourself or your loved one if somebody is having seizures, very important. Then doing physical examination. And then we might get pictures of the brain to see what is going on in the brain and what can cause the seizures. And we do a head CT scan. Usually it's a crude picture of the brain that happens in the emergency department, but a much better resolution and better pictures of the brain is the called brain MRI. And brain MRI is giving us detailed information on the brain structure, and that is best to be done with epilepsy protocol. So epilepsy protocol MRI with thin cuts through the temporal lobe, and it is best to be on 3 Tesla scanner rather than 1.5 Tesla scanner. The stronger the magnet, the better the resolution, and it's best to be read by a doctor who is experienced in the brain imaging. And still 50% might be negative, which is the brain will look completely normal. And the next test is EEG. So EEG is electroencephalogram, is checking and evaluating the electricity of the brain, which is one of the important tools in diagnosis of epilepsy. EEG, we will put wires and study the electricity of the brain. The best practices for EEG test is to do a sleep-deprived EEG, and that can be like you wake up early in the morning and then go sleep-deprived so that you can sleep during the test. And then if that test is negative, which happens in about 60 to 70% of the time, then we might do another EEG or do prolonged EEG for 8 hours. And sometimes we can do a longer EEG for like about 24 to 72 hours. So the length of EEG depends on the case, and we prefer the EEG the patient sleeps in, because the electrical activity or abnormalities can show up much better during sleep. One important information about EEG is EEG is as good as the one who reads it. I just want to be politically correct here. EEG is a test that like gives you squiggly lines, and then you need somebody who's really trained well to recognize what is epileptic activity and what is normal variants. And if the doctor is not experienced in reading EEG, they might overinterpret it or read normal variants as abnormal epileptic activity, which happens a lot. So you want to make sure that the one who reads the EEG has a good experience in reading it. So putting all the testing together, yes, you can have epilepsy with everything to be normal. EEG normal, MRI normal, all of these things can be like small sources or beyond the resolution of EEG or MRI. So yes, we can make the diagnosis of epilepsy with everything is normal, and we call it idiopathic epilepsy, means we don't know the cause of this. And speaking of causes of epilepsy, there are lots of causes for epilepsy, and also the classification system try to kind of organize these causes. And the most common cause worldwide is infection. So infectious causes, when there is an infection that leads to scarring in the brain and leads to disturbance in electricity and causes seizures. And the most common worldwide infection is neurocysticercosis, which is a worm that is coming from undercooked pork products, and that can lead to worm going into the brain and causing seizures to happen. Other infections like meningitis, encephalitis, and viral and bacterial infections. The second cause is autoimmune cause, which means that the immune system is attacking the brain as a foreign agent or a foreign substance, and that can cause inflammation in the brain, leading to epilepsy. One of the famous causes is that girl in the movie Brain on Fire, which she has autoimmune epilepsy due to an NMDA receptor, and we can test for these receptors as well. The next is genetic causes. Genes are the makeup of the body and the electricity and the channels and receptors, and sometimes these genes can be disturbed by mutations, which leads to excess electricity or decreased inhibition, and that can lead to epilepsy. And usually these will present early in life. Next is metabolic causes. So metabolism is the enzyme working in the body to make product and degrade others and so on. And sometimes one of these enzymes can be defected, and that can either lead to toxicity of accumulation of toxic substance, or there'll be a lack in one of the essential ingredients for the healthy brain that can lead to seizures. And usually it is associated with other symptoms as well. And the last is the structural etiology. Structural causes of the brain is anything that causes scarring or disturbance in the build of the brain, and common ones are stroke, traumatic brain injury, brain tumors, or anything that can affect the building of the brain and the formation of the brain, like when the brain is being formed in the uterus while the baby is in the womb, the cells might not migrate all over or might not organize themselves right, and that can be leading to some cortical dysplasia or heterotropia, all these names for abnormal cell formation, and that can end up causing seizures. This is important to put all of the causes together, that these causes can be different so much by the age. In the first 6 years of life, most of the causes are due to perinatal or like around birth trauma, asphyxia or lack of oxygen, infections, or genetic causes. These are the common cause, or sometimes metabolism issues. So these are the what cause epilepsy in the little children. And then there will be a steady state of epilepsy incidence. It can happen at any age, but you know, it's much lower afterwards in the 20s and 30s and 40s, even though you can have that at this age. So even I am at risk of having epilepsy because no one is immune from epilepsy. But anyways, so after age 65, there will be a huge peak of incidence of epilepsy. People start having seizures at that age, and mostly is because of scarring in the brain by stroke, traumatic brain injury, and brain tumors. These are the main causes of epilepsy in this age group. And again, it is important to know that about 50% of the time, we don't know what causes epilepsy, and we call it idiopathic epilepsy, which is, you know, like a fancy word of us saying we don't know. It's called idiopathic. No one knows. So now you know what is epilepsy and what caused it, then how we get a good control of the seizures. The best treatment for epilepsy, which works in about 50 to 70% of the time, is anti-seizure medications. There are lots of medications that we can give to control the electricity in the brain. They are called anti-seizure medications. And about we have now about like 32 medications for epilepsy, and lots more coming in the pipeline, which I'm monitoring very closely. So, you know, I will make videos in the future about every new treatment that are being made and will come to the market about epilepsy. But these medications will control the electricity in the brain, and they work inside the system. As we said earlier, they will decrease the electricity from flowing, they will block these excitation receptors, or they will increase the inhibition in the brain that will overall restore the balance in the brain and control the electricity. It is important that these treatments are supposed to control seizures, but might not control the epilepsy itself. So usually we know that epilepsy in most of the time is non-curable. I mean, there is no cure for epilepsy, but we have very good successful treatments to control seizures and control epilepsy so that you can take treatment and live your life very well. And this comes to how long we need to treat epilepsy. The treatment of epilepsy is long time. It's not 2 years. It depends on the case and what causes epilepsy. If the cause is really permanent, then the treatment should be as well long term. There are some quick considerations about seizure medications. We try to make sure we give the best treatment and the best medicine for the patient to give it the best chances of having control of seizures and lowest side effects. So in my clinic, I never give two patients the same treatment because everyone is unique and their background matters a lot. So if somebody has psychiatric history, we should avoid Keppra because Keppra or levetiracetam has lots of psychiatric side effects. It can cause depression, anxiety, anger, all of that. So we avoid it in these patients. Lamictal on the other side, or lamotrigine, can help to, it's a mood stabilizer, it's an antidepressant, so it helps with that. Depakote or valproic acid is very bad in pregnancy, so we avoid it in any woman of childbearing age. It also causes weight gain and so on. Zonisamide can help a lot in patients with alcohol abuse, so they can decrease craving. So every patient has a unique properties, and every medicine has unique properties that we try to give to a certain patient. So it is not one size fits all, and it is not Keppra for everybody. When we start the treatment for epilepsy, We give medications, we give the best treatment, and then we slowly build it up so that the body gets used to it, and then we monitor. And then we see if the seizures come back, then we might increase the dose. And then if the seizures come back again, we increase the dose to the maximum, either maximum tolerated dose, or we reach to the point that the seizures are not controlled, then we add a second medication or replace the current medicine. And then if the seizures do not get controlled, then usually we might change the medicine, but we might be dealing with what we call drug-resistant epilepsy or refractory epilepsy. This is a type of epilepsy that is resistant to treatment with medications, and then we need to explore other avenues of treatment, such as potential for surgical treatment. And yes, we do treat with epilepsy with surgery. If there is one spot in the brain, there's a scar or cells did not form right, and it is safe to do so, we can take out that area. And it has very good success, and one of the safest surgeries of the brain. Or we can implant devices such as vagus nerve stimulation, deep brain stimulation, and responsive neurostimulation. We have videos on every one of these treatments, so you can explore more in depth. But yes, we can treat epilepsy with other treatments other than medications that can be surgical treatment. And then we can do some diet therapy. So diet therapy is like ketogenic diet. So ketogenic diet can be very helpful in patients with epilepsy, especially in little children, where we control what they eat, and it can be helpful. But there are certain types of seizures and epilepsy does not work with diet therapy, especially kids who have metabolism issues. So make sure you check with your doctor before starting diet therapy as well. So it can be a little tricky to spot on seizures and know that your symptoms are seizures or not. So I made this whole video about description and details of the epileptic seizures from the other events that are not at all seizures and can be misdiagnosed in as epilepsy in this video that you can see next. And stay healthy and see you in the next video. Salam.